Hello all, welcome. Today we will discuss a case of methanol poisoning. We have Dr. Riaz who is going to present the case. Over to you, Riaz.
Thank you, sir. A middle-aged man was brought to ER with a short history from the EMT that he has been referred from outside the hospital with a suspected methanol poisoning, following which he is having blurring of vision. So in my initial 10-second assessment, patient was fully conscious-oriented and patient was completely able to obey to my commands. But early presenting issue, chief complaint he was mentioning was he was having blurring of vision. So I immediately did my primary survey. In primary survey, airway is patent, no oral secretions, and cervical spine also appears patent. And breathing was only 18%, with a not associated tachypnea was not there. Air entry was bilaterally equal, and saturation also it was maintaining 98% in room air, sir. Then went to the circulation. He was maintaining a BP 134/78 mmHg, and heart rate was also in the range of 78 per minute, sir. Then came to the disability. GCS was 15/15, but pupils were mid dilated, around 3.5 bilaterally sluggish and not reacting to light, sir. Both the eyes were not reacting to light, otherwise GRBs was within normal limit, and exposure what peripheries were warm, no other external injuries or burns were noted, sir. So my primary survey appears to be patent. Only thing was he is having pupillary no response to pupillary.
What was the respiratory rate?
Respiratory rate was also 18 per minute. No associated tachypnea, okay. Nothing was there.
Okay.
Since it was a suspected methanol poisoning from the history, I did an ABG to rule out there is no acidosis. But ABG was also showing a normal anion, normal acid-base status, sir, and with a normal pH and normal lactate level was there. Since the patient is currently stable, only his issue is with the pupillary asymmetry, I went to go for a secondary survey, sir. In secondary survey, there is no history of any allergies, no history of any past medical history, no relevant past history. Then last meal was yesterday night, sir. And even lead to the event is that there is an alleged history of illicit alcohol consumption around 5 days back, prior to our hospital arrival, and following which within 24 hours he has gradually developed a blurring of vision.
Can you elaborate a little more on from where he got?
Actually, he was in some hill station, and he along with his few friends were trying to make some hand rub material, for which he has locally purchased some alcohol, and he actually misused it. He mixed this alcohol.
There's a lot of practical levels now, no?
Yes,
during
sir.
The COVID times, there's a lot of hand rubs being
yes, sir.
Even
yes.
At local places, at homes and things like that. And you should all keep in mind that the local spirit, which is even for making hand sanitizers, should be mixed with methanol.
Sir.
For obvious reasons, so that
obvious
people are not
for industrial purpose only.
So in other places where there, of course, illicit liquor making can lead to all these, but any other solutions which are commonly found can have any other alcohol?
Any other industrial?
Yeah.
One is methanol can be there in whenever there is a commercial available alcohol itself. Sometimes there can be pollutant level methanol presence, or in case of spirits, commercially available spirit, aftershave lotions, or in any sprays, or any kind with this kind of hand rubs. And these are the major areas where
paint
also, the tinner that we use to dilute the paint, it all contains methanol, sir. Majority of the commercially available alcohol contains, usually they mix 1% of methanol, so that it won't be used for this kind of drinking purpose, sir. So that's okay. The major areas where
there. Okay, so you had a middle-aged man who has been brought with a history of blurring of vision.
Yes, sir.
5 days back, he had a consumption of probably an illicit alcohol. That is the history. So from the history itself, it's clearly pointing towards a methanol toxicity. He had only had blurring of vision.
He developed blurring of vision, following which he immediately went to a local hospital by post 48 hours only. Then they suspected a methanol poisoning. Actually, they have initiated the treatment also. From what the from the details that I got from the referral letter, it's showing that there he has presented with a high severe tachypnea and all, and his ABG was showing metabolic acidosis.
Okay.
Following which they have given the I mean, fomepizole is not commercially available in our part of state.
Mm.
So they have given actually alcohol, and they didn't make the available, I mean, pharmacologically available alcohol. Actually, they bought the alcohol available from the shop, and they gave him around 150 ml of alcohol was given to the patient, sir. And along with, he was immediately initiated on a hemodialysis also.
Okay.
And even though on the initial day, he was only metabolic acidosis and blurring of vision, no other end organ damage was noted. And subsequently, after three sessions of dialysis, his acidosis was improving. And his initial lab parameters were showing an high osmolal gap as well as high anion gap metabolic acidosis. And his samples, blood and urine samples, were sent for toxicological analysis also. And it was done in actually our hospital only, in Amrita, where it is a WHO accredited toxicological center. And even though we were not able to detect the methanol level, we discussed this case with our consultant, Dr. V.V. Plesser. He said that it may be because of delayed presentation.
And also dialyzed.
One key thing from the history could be, was there anyone else who consumed the same thing?
Yes, sir, of course. Even though from the initial day they didn't give the history, when we cross-checked them, colleagues who has consumed the same thing, they were admitted in serious state in different hospitals. And when we inquired with that hospital, they are all having
similar presentation. So let's imagine this patient has come directly to our emergency room. Okay. So for the discussion sake, this patient had already had this, and he had, after 5 days only, he has come to our department. So let's imagine within 24 hours or soon after the consumption, so the patient is in front of you. Let's start from the airway management and decontamination.
First thing is that when we are suspecting a methanol poisoning, first we have to just inquire whether he has consumed methanol alone or whether he has taken along with the alcohol. Because if it is consumed along with the ethanol, then it is an added advantage, because methanol metabolism will be delayed.
Can you explain the metabolism?
Because entire mechanism is that this alcohol, first it will be acted by alcohol dehydrogenase, and it will be converted into the end product formic acid. So methanol will become formic acid at the end, and this formic acid end product is the one which is causing the retinal damage by causing mitochondrial injury. So whenever ethanol is there, ethanol dehydrogenase enzyme will competitively, the ethanol will competitively consume this ethanol dehydrogenase enzyme. So the methanol byproducts will be, the production will be very much reduced. So that's an added advantage when associated ethanol is also consumed along with the methanol.
Okay.
So first we have to get that history. Then first and foremost, we have to do the decontamination. Proper decontamination to prevent continuous exposure. All the parts should be decontaminated and secured in an airtight bag.
So can you tell me the role of GA decontamination?
First, we will be doing the primary survey, and we will be securing the airway breathing.
ABC is done.
Then decontamination part, since these are all alcohol materials, the gastrointestinal absorption is very rapid. So there is only limited role if you are doing within the first 1 hour, if you are putting a nasogastric tube and immediately doing a gastric lavage, you may get some contents. But post that, there is no role for any charcoal hemoperfusion or nothing.
Activated charcoal,
there is no role, sir, because the GI absorption is very rapid. So the almost entire content will be immediately absorbed to the bloodstream, sir.
Okay.
So that's
so you have done your primary survey. So what are key investigation that you will ask for?
So, important things that has to be done is, first and foremost, we have to get an assess the GCS, and second thing is we have to send for the ABG. We have to assess the acid base status of the patient. And because we are suspect in case of methanol poisonings, we always get an high anion gap metabolic acidosis. And we have to send the serum toxic level also at the same time itself, and we have to calculate the osmolar also. When the calculated minus measured will give the osmolar gap.
So we have to do the osmolar gap.
Yeah.
That is a key message that we need to pass. So whenever you have having some patient with unknown ingestion, you are getting a high anion gap metabolic acidosis, as a protocol, it is mandatory to look for the osmolar gap, which is usually missed by a normal practitioner. They don't have enough knowledge about this, they can miss this. So that is a key thing, that whenever you have gotten high osmolar gap more than 10, you have to always think in terms of an alcohol ingestion. Especially it can be either methanol or ethylene glycol. So these are the two things that you need to keep in your mind. So what was the osmolar gap?
Sir,
you have got any idea? Because the referral letters, anything we got?
They have only mentioned that it is in a high anion gap. Oh. We didn't get their exact lab parameters. Sir.
Okay. So whenever you have a clear history like this, it will be high. Yes. But usually the problem happens is that we don't get any history. The patient is in front of you and you are looking in terms of, and maybe he's already an underlying chronic liver disease patient or something. Yes, we are looking for why this patient is having an high anion gap metabolic acidosis. We are not getting any answer.
Yes,
so that point, definitely whenever you have high anion gap metabolic acidosis, go for your osmolar gap. Yes, which is pretty simple. You calculate the osmolarity, calculated and measured osmolarity, then that difference is the osmolar gap. So it is pretty. Can you just tell the formula?
So measured we will get from the lab. Calculated what we have to do is 2 into sodium plus glucose by 18 plus blood urea nitrogen by 2.4.
Okay.
You only have to calculate it, sir. It's pretty easy. So these are the first major investigation what we have to do, and the next important thing
also
is
your electrolytes.
Routine
acid base disorder means electrolyte will be the next. And also you have to think in terms of other major thing, hypoglycemia. Again, there can be high chance of there is can be an underlying liver failure, we don't know.
Yes.
But hypoglycemia, that's the next thing. Hypoglycemia, electrolytes, in electrolytes most importantly
potassium.
So whenever you have high anion gap metabolic acidosis, usually there can be associated hyperkalemia. But if it is hypokalemia, that is more dangerous. Okay.
One important thing is sometimes it ethylene glycol is a one which is more similar to methanol. In that case, hypocalcemia can be there because
also
calcium oxalate crystals and
they can have features of tetany.
Tetany,
so that is a, again important. So once the patient we are planning to intubate and all, it's a big question. So it's a directly if you go ahead and intubate, there can which are some drugs can cause. They can cause severe spasms, tetanies, and you will not be able to intubate also. So
yes,
you have to check all these electrolytes. Maybe an IABG, you can get an ionized calcium, and you can look that and you can start treating with calcium glucamate if there is evidence of hypoglycemia. So as you said, ethylene glycol, methanol, similar presentation. And you can have three, like you can have ethylene glycol, you can have methanol and methanol with ethanol. So this will be the three presentation that you need to suspect. Okay.
So we are talking about dialysis, no? What are the indications for dialysis?
So once we did the initial management, we have to, the treatment part I will come gradually, sir. For first time thing is that airway ABCD, our primary survey, we have to take care. Next thing is that we have got the ABG. If the ABG is showing acidosis, the patient is having a pH 7.3, first we can give bicarbonate.
Okay.
Bicarbonate, one method is that we can calculate 1 milliequivalent per kg, bolus can be given, or what we can do is that we can calculate the
deficit,
delta bicarbonate. We have to measure the bicarbonate gap, multiply with the 0.5 into the body weight can be given, and the value what we get is the deficit there. The 50% of it can be given as a bolus there. So we have to give bicarbonate. Why is that? Whenever a patient is having acidosis will cause increased end organ penetration for methanol. So if you correct the acidosis itself, this methanol entry into the retina or other organs can be reduced. So bicarbonate. Next is use of giving fomepizole or an alcohol itself. Fomepizole, it's an actual antidote here. It's an alcohol dehydrogenase inhibitor. But the issue is that it is high costly as well as unavailability. That's a major issue. The dose recommended dose is 15 mg per kg bolus dose, followed by 10 mg per kg. You have to give 4th hourly. But if you are giving dialysis, we have to give 2 4th hourly also.
Okay.
That is the fomepizole.
So,
then is alcohol.
Okay.
Ethylene glycol. I already mentioned that ethylene alcohol, if you are giving
ethanol.
Ethanol, if you are giving along with that, alcohol dehydrogenase enzyme will be competitively inhibited, so that the formation of formic acid can be reduced. So the pharmacologically prepared one is we have to use 10% ethanol. How to dilute it also I will just tell you, sir. We have to get 1 liter of 5% dextrose. In that we have to remove 100 ml, and to that we have to add around 100 ml of 10% rectified spirit has to be added. And in that, from that, it is actually 10% ethanol.
And you need preferably a center line for
that. Yeah, it is highly irritant, and preferably center line should be used. And again, here we can start with the 10 ml per kg bolus can be given, followed by titrated infusion to maintain a level around 200 mg per deciliter ethanol level should be given. So these are the first important treatment, fomepizole or giving ethanol. Third important thing is role of dialysis. Dialysis is done to immediately remove this alcohol as well as their toxic byproducts. So dialysis preferred is high definition dialysis only. There is no role for CRRT or slow or
hemoperfusion
or peritoneal dialysis. It doesn't help. Sir.
It's dialysable.
Oh yes,
it's a it dialysable. Is dialysable. You can go straight away dialysis. No need of further adding anything else.
So indication as such is whenever the patient presents with the initial acidosis itself, the patient is having pH less than 7.3, or the patient is having any end organ damage, or if the serum methanol level is more than 20 milligram per deciliter availability.
20 to 30 milligram, we can take it, no issues.
Or whenever the patient, even though the we have to get the serum level by gas chromatography and all, but it is rarely available. So whenever we are suspecting high osmolal gap with the high neon gap thing also, we can with the normal with impending acidosis pH also, it's advisory to go ahead with the dialysis. Early dialysis always gives a good outcome, sir.
Okay.
So but that's
the initial volume of injection is high, like more than 50 ml.
Yes, sir.
Fatal dose whenever you are suspecting 70 to 100 ml,
50 to 100 ml. Seizures also.
Yes, sir.
Seizures.
So that's a dialysis. I mean, another one, last thing also I have to add is we have to give supplements like folic acids that in a very high dose, around we have to give 50 mg Q6 hourly IV folic acid or a folinic acid. Along with we have to give thiamine and pyridoxine is also advised, sir. These are the supplemental medicines I have to give with the case of methanol poisoning.
Just two quick questions regarding soda bicarb. Again, I need emphasis.
Yes,
because majority of the time in a toxicology scenario, if it is a TCA or whatever be the thing, you need to, whenever you see a broad QRS, you will start, you will say that you need to start bicarbonate, okay, and many of them are not very clear how to start a bicarbonate therapy. Can we just elaborate a little bit on that?
Sir, there are commercially two available forms, 8.4% and 7.2%. In 8.4, what we get is 50 ml of 1 ml gives 1 milliequivalent.
Okay.
While the 7.2, it is like 1 ml will give only 44 ml.
That means you have a 50 ml vial of 7.2, you will have 44 milliequivalent. When you have 8.4, you will have 50 ml is 50 milliequivalent. That is 1 ml, 1 milliequivalent. Other will be approximately 0.8. So when you want to calculate it, it is not big deal, but it is always better to know what we are going to give to the patient. Whether you have, you know, hospital is having 7.2 and 8.4, maybe it will be hardly a difference. When you are going to give high doses in this poisoning and all, you need to give high doses, maybe you will have a change in like saying 30 to 40 milliequivalents. So again, you have said regarding the calculation, that is again how to start it. That is again, many of them have very confusions regarding it. And how safe is to start soda bicarbonate, whether it has got any complications?
Yes, sir. Soda, one is it is highly viscous material. Okay. Sir. Another thing is that it can cause, if the patient is not intubated and all, sudden dissociation into carbon dioxide and sudden buildup of PCO2E7 possibility, sudden respiratory acidosis can be there in the ABG.
Okay.
Another
more
thing
than
is
that,
pulmonary edema is
yeah, that is already very important thing, because already this patient might be having a renal failure.
Yes,
so when you are suddenly giving some 100 milliequivalents, there can be some 100 ml, suddenly it will be a hypertonic saline. So there can be rapid volume increase and they can go for pulmonary edema. And regarding potassium, it can cause hypokalemia. So these are the problems that we need to face. So giving bicarbonate, it's said very easily, but you have to be with the patient and you have to correctly give the dose and maybe a little bit slower, fine. It is actually just to your bridging till you getting your final way of getting out your acids.
Yes.
That is your dialysis. You have to go ahead and get dialyze the patient.
Yes.
Maybe initial 2-3 hours you start, maybe by the time you are getting prepared for dialysis, once dialysis is done, they are okay. So that will be the best thing if it's a dialysable toxin like methanol and all. So that's it. Okay. So now what happened to this patient? He got admitted.
See, he was admitted in that hospital.
Mm-hmm.
He already underwent 3 sessions of dialysis.
Mm-hmm.
And also their visual assessment was done at that point. In visual assessment, they are found that there is a perception of light on both the eyes.
Okay.
And there is maybe they in earlier finding will be an RIPD, but they have not mentioned anything.
So that is again one key thing. So when a patient is coming to the ER,
yeah,
the only thing that you will be, can you just elaborate on RIPD?
RIPD is relative afferent pupillary defect.
Mm.
It is actually done by swinging flash test.
Mm.
What it is that there will be absence of direct consensual reflex, but the presence of indirect consensual reflex will be there. So by just moving from doing a swinging flash test, we will see that whenever the direct reflex goes there, there will be dilatation. While doing an indirect reflex test, it will will be contraction. So presence of RAPD will be an earlier presentation of an methanol induced retinal damage.
What are the visual problems that you need to anticipate? One is the initial presentation, symptoms.
Symptoms will be, patient will develop a headache along with a mild blurring of vision will be there, sir. Gradually, there will be blurring followed by a complete progressive worsening of vision, sir.
Central?
Central scotoma is another the presentation.
So, the earliest finding, as you said, will be an RIPD. So, whenever somebody is coming to you with an unknown ingestion, you are seeing a metabolic acidosis, you do the swinging flash test, and you see an RIPD that is highly suggestive of a methanol ingestion. So, that is...
Usually, methanol can their studies show that there is methanol basal ganglia infarct or bleed is a expected complications in case of methanol poisoning.
Anything can be done for this optic neuritis? Any role of steroids?
Sir, there is a conventional, some people treat with high dose of IV methylprednisolone and all, but there is no definitive indication for steroid for the reversing the
methanol. As a result, yeah, exactly. Because it is a directly toxin mediated. If it is an inflammation mediator or something else like an autoimmune disease causing, maybe it will have some role. But what are the options, any new treatment advancements?
One, it is some amount of bone marrow transplant.
Stem cell
derived mononuclear cells is available. It is a trial ongoing,
okay,
in which patient who has completely lost vision, if following which mononuclear cell injection, the patient's vision is gradually improving. It's under a trial only, sir, but it is not.
These are the recent upcoming things. So, primary
probably
mass
casualty. Mass casualty. Sir, as per WHO, whenever the more than 3 patients presenting with a suspected methanol poisoning over a period of 48 hours, then we have to consider it is an methanol poisoning outbreak in our society. We should immediately inform the health authorities also. And in such a scenario, our triage will be based on 3 things. Any patient presenting with altered mental status, any associated blurring of vision, and immediate ABG for all patients. If the patient is having high acidosis, we should always suspect a methanol or a methanol along with an ethanol poisoning.
Or
ethylene glycol poisoning.
So ethylene glycol, where it is used, ethylene glycol?
Sir, ethylene glycol is actually an antifreeze substance which is actually added to our petroleum or diesel material so that the in cold countries or cold climate area it doesn't get freeze. Or other application is that it is present in glass cleaners and everything, it is there, sir, ethylene glycol.
This will be the 3 presentation. So whenever you have more than 3 patients presenting you with the similar symptoms with visual disturbance, always think that it is a mass casualty, and you have to activate, and initial management will be recording upon their ABG, bicarbonate, anion gap, bicarbonate, osmolar gap, and end organ damage. And depending upon that, you can decide on dialysis or not dialysis. So, for example, you don't have rectified spirit available. So you only have commercially available preparation. So majority of the time the patient consume methanol and ethanol, and luckily they are escaping. Because it is been consumed with ethanol. That is why many of the things are happening like that. So what can be done for this patient?
Sir, the commercial available alcohol is containing around 30-50% ethanol in it.
So depends upon different things.
Brands. And we can give around 125 to 150 ml of this commercially available alcohol itself by oral ingestion.
Okay.
And
so that itself can prevent this. No. So if you have any dilemma, that is a message that we need to pass on. We are thinking in terms of fomepizole, IV ethanol, and all. If it is not available, commercially available alcohol is available. So how freely, it all depends upon your state policy. So you can easily ask them to take 125 to 150 ml of commercially available alcohol. That can definitely will help for this group of patients. Anything else?
Probably I think you can control with the hand rub thing only.
You can just put it on.
I think since it's the corona time and all, and lot of hand rub manufacturing has been started, so we should always remember taking hand rub can lead to such scenarios.
So that is maybe there are some case reports also after consuming hand rub, there can some 1 or 2 mortality also has been reported. So even in our year we have 2 or 3 patients who had come after consuming, but luckily they didn't had any other major manifestation except for some gastrointestinal symptoms, and they got discharged. So again, when the lockdown was very severe, when the availability has significantly reduced, the alcohol availability, that is the time when we had this instance. But right now I think they are back to normal. So hope that's fine. Okay. Thank you, Riyaz, for a very good presentation.
Thanks.
Thank you.